Good morning, everybody. This is a wonderful full room. It's a pleasure to look at you all. Welcome to the new school. Welcome to the Institute for Retired Professionals. I'm Miriam Lawrence. I'm the interim director of the IRP, and it is my great pleasure to welcome you this morning. We have a lovely program in store for you. I'd like to call your attention to two of the pieces of paper that were waiting for you at the desk when you came in. One is our public programs, Fridays at 1. The IRP, which I'll tell you about in a moment, has a public program series, and we have one left for the semester, and that is on Friday, April 28th, in this room at 1 o'clock, and we will be viewing a documentary by Alexandra Isles on the effects of blacklisting on the civil rights movement. Spoiler alert, it was not good. And we would like you all to join us. The other piece of paper indicates that we have one information session left if you're interested in exploring the IRP. That is, more will be scheduled, but there's one left on our current schedule, and that is on Monday, April 17th, 2 o'clock. Now, for those of you who wonder, what is this thing I'm referring to, the IRP? The IRP is a group at the New School of retired and semi-retired professionals and people from all walks of life who come together to form a collegial academic intellectual community. The IRP is only, the curriculum is made up by the members. We are both the teachers and the students of the classes, which we call study groups. And the curriculum is limited only by the creativity, imagination, and interests of the members. So if that sounds like something that you'd be interested in, please join us on April 17th. Both pieces of paper that you have out front have both our email address and our phone number. So please, if you're interested in either or both, call us or email us for a reservation. Today we have a wonderful program with our very own Dr. Renee Solomon. I would like to introduce to you the co-chair of the Our Stage of Life Committee that is hosting this event. And this is their inaugural event because they've just formed. It's a committee to deal with and discuss issues of aging. And if we don't discuss issues of aging at the IRP, then I don't know who should. So I'd like to introduce Nancy Yates. She's the co-chair of the committee, and she'd like to say a few words. Nancy?
Hi, is this okay? All right. So Renee and I want to acknowledge and thank everyone involved for their assistance in creating this event. As members of the Institute for Retired Professionals, we bring our intellectual, hopefully studious selves to the new school to continue learning and sharing that learning with our members. But we also benefit in other ways from being in this unique and special community as seniors, and we explore new approaches and tools to aging as best we can, as Renee, our speaker, puts it. This event is the outcome of a group effort, and I want to warmly thank all members of our Stage of Life Committee for their participation and their ideas. Most especially, I would like to thank our Miriam and Amy, who provide the key support and facilitate the successful delivery of our events in so many different ways. They take action and they make things happen. So we're very, very, very much appreciative of the support that they give us. And finally, we are grateful for the wonderful facilities and other support afforded to us by the new school for all our programs. And welcome.
Thank you, Nancy. I didn't know I was gonna get a plug in there, but thank you. We're very sorry that Dr. Jacqueline Mondrose can't be with us today, but instead we have a wonderful substitute. Renee will be introduced by Dr. Anne Barak-Weiss, who is a social worker practitioner, educator, and consultant who taught two generations of students at Columbia's School of Social Work and is now an associate faculty member in Columbia's Program of Narrative Medicine. She's the author of The Caregiver's Tale, Loss and Renewal in Memoirs and Family Life, and The Lioness in Winter, Writing an Old Woman's Life. Anne?
Good morning. It is wonderful to be here with a group of peers on this beautiful spring day and to introduce my colleague and friend, Dr. Renee Solomon. Although it can't be a full introduction because I've only known Renee for 40 years. I know before we met, she'd graduated from Brooklyn College and from Columbia College with a master's degree, and it was only later that she received her doctorate from Hunter. I met Renee in 1977 when I began teaching at the Columbia University School of Social Work, where she was already on faculty. We had things in common shared with many women of our generation. We married young, we had children young, and were stay-at-home mothers for a time before returning to social work practice. Our teaching followed years of experience in the field, and our doctorates were received many years after that, somewhat the reverse of the way things are done today. No one matched Renee for popularity with students. Her courses were always filled first. Her student followers were nicknamed Renee Boppers and were so bonded by semester's end that they wanted to keep on meeting. It was actually quite envious. And of course, she did all that academics do, writing on group work, which was her field of specialization, consulting and teaching places far, Australia and near, and Connecticut. But the main thing we had in common was that we were gerontologists. Our teaching in aging was based on practice in aging, hers at the Hebrew Home for the Aged, and mine at the Jewish Home for the Aged. And the clients from whom we learned were a generation ahead of us. Most were immigrants from Eastern Europe, coming as young adults to a new land, often alone, making their way at low-skilled jobs. Men and women had little education or opportunity. The women usually stopped working when they were married, always focused on their children, the sons and daughters who were doctors and teachers, escaping the Bronx and Brooklyn of their birth for Long Island and Westchester and points far away. We learned so much from these clients. How we can survive the loss of loved ones, about the old body and mind and the many ways they can fail us, and important lessons on enduring what seemed to us then to be unendurable. Now we are as old as they were then, and we need to learn what they couldn't teach us, how we, a generation of educated, working, independent women and men, are to live out our own old age. For though our old bodies may be much like theirs, even with advances in the medical sciences since then, our minds and spirits were cultivated in another time. We, the baby boomers, and those who were born a decade or so before, are now on a new frontier, one of possibilities, of many ways of finding fulfillment in our own last years. Renee Solomon, who has practiced, taught, and lived the experience, is the perfect person to guide us, and I can't wait to hear what she is going to say.
Thank you so much, Anne.
I need my stool. Wait. Thank you.
Now you see me. Thank you so much, Anne. I'm so nervous. It's like there's no heavier burden than a great potential. And with an introduction like Anne gave me, how can I top that? You know, oh, my God. but I also know how smart the people with whom, at the IRP, with whom I've been associated for the last 10 or 11 years are. And so I'm always scared when talking to a group like you. There. Is that better? Good. Oh. What else? Okay, that's it. I became aware as I prepared these remarks that although I always agonize over speeches, still not good. But I can't talk into it and read at the same time. Sure I can, right? Yes, we can. Oh, please, if only we could. A moment's silence, deep. Let's get grounded. This is the life. Okay. I became aware as I was writing this that I always agonize over speeches. This time was harder than usual. I realized that the closer my own life reflects what I have spoken of as a gerontologist and taught these many years, that as I myself age, the harder it is for me to make unequivocal statements about growing older. On the other hand, always seems to lurk in the background. Bette Davis said many years ago that old age is not for sissies. I merely shrugged. Not anymore. Aging well is tough, and it is not for sissies, and it can be done. We live in an ageist society, which sees chronological age above 60 as a negative, a society which glorifies youth and beauty. We can, and some of us do, internalize these attitudes and begin to believe and behave as though we're no longer vibrant, intelligent adults. Researchers have found that ageism negatively affects mental health, a sense of well-being, and even an older person's will to live. Because ageism is pervasive and akin to sexism and racism, it is another stereotype with which we all grew up. And like these other stereotypes, it is a chronic stressor with adverse psychological and physiological effects. We do need to be aware of how over the years we may have incorporated ageist ideas with which we then assault ourselves. I have trouble with the language used to refer to people over 65, and this is my hobby horse. We have gone from golden age to senior citizens to elderly to elders to the latest olders. What is the problem? Young people are called young or teens, not juniors. Is nomenclature a reflection of ageism? Is being old, being called old, so unacceptable that we invent euphemisms for it? My friend was on the treadmill at her gym the other day, doing her usual 3.3 speed, when a younger man next to her said, "Gee, you're good." "What do you mean?" "Well, you're not 27. "Right, I'm not, so?" The phrase "diminished expectations" rang in my friend's head, and she was infuriated. "These are the best of times, these are the worst of times," wrote Charles Dickens. That holds true for most of life's other stages, and it does so for the post-retirement years. These are also the years of the greatest diversity amongst us. Some of us took early retirement, others stop working at age 70, while some at 85 still work. It is mistaken to speak of old and older people as a monolithic group. And I guess in saying this, I'm asking your indulgence or maybe apologizing for what may sound too generalized or too particularized. Aging has been characterized as a time of loss. Yes, it is. And the hardest part of aging for me has been the illness and death of dear old friends. But more on this later. However, we experience loss at all ages. Physical loss resulting from accidents and illness, relationship loss, the death of grandparents, parents, and friends, especially during the years of AIDS. We experience cognitive loss. For how many years have I been looking for my keys and glasses? Of course, I forgot algebra by the time I graduated from high school. There have been job losses, deaths of beloved pets. The list is long. What is it then that makes old age different and harder? Stanley Cooper Smith, psychiatrist, speaks of the omniconvergence of loss in old age. This is different, he says, from younger years when indeed losses were experienced. The losses in old age, however, occur simultaneously or serially. Coping with omniconvergent losses requires energy levels which for most older people have diminished over time. It is the need to deal with omniconvergent losses that I propose distinguishes aging from other life stages. We are the first generation in modern history that has lived so long and where there are so many people over 65. We're experiencing the aging explosion as well as the aging or graying of America. The statistics are dramatic. In the United States, the proportion of the over 65 population in 1979 was a mere 9.7%. It is projected to increase from today's 13% to 20% in 2030. Numbers will double from approximately 35 million in 2000 to an estimated 71 million in 2030. More, the number of people over 80 will increase from 9.3 million in 2000 to 19.5 million in 2030, making the older and oldest cohorts the fastest growing parts of the over 65 population. The 77 million baby boomers, and here we go again, blaming the baby boomers. Those born between 1946 and 1964 are largely responsible for the numerical increase. Boomers began turning 65 in 2011, and each year for the next 20 years, 3.5 million of them will turn 55. Implications for public policy are enormous, and fortunately, not our focus today. The pattern applies globally. More old people are living longer, which is accounted for by a worldwide decline in fertility rates and the simultaneous increase in life expectancy. Longevity increases reflect victories in treating and preventing infant mortality, infectious diseases, and acute illnesses. When chronic diseases and degenerative illnesses such as cardiovascular disease and cancer are conquered, these numbers will increase dramatically. Gerontologists now see not one, but three distinct groups of people who are over 65, each with distinctive life tasks to master. For the first time in history, 20 to 30% of our lives will be spent in active retirement. 20 to 30%, that's a lot of years. These three cohorts of people differ markedly from each other and from earlier cohorts. For the most part, people over 65 today are better educated and healthier. Families live at a greater distance Women have and still work outside the home. We are better off financially than our parents, and in many cases, and sadly so, better off than our children. The oldest among us were born before there were TV or computers, before air travel was commonplace, when neighborhoods were homogeneous. We live now in a technological world with a new device to master each year, and lucky are those whose grandchildren live nearby. I'm not one of those whose kids live nearby. And where people are beginning to sign up for space travel. The question for us today is, how do we age well? How do we spend perhaps the next one-third of our lives in ways which give us pleasure and which we deem meaningful? In the past, we spoke of successful aging. I prefer to speak of aging as well as we can. I begin by sharing with you the last lesson given to me by my friend and mentor, Dr. Rose Dobroff. Some of you may know her. She died last year. There she was, seriously hearing impaired, having a very hard time walking, her short-term memory failing her. And she told me how lucky she was. Lucky, I thought. And she said, "Renee, I have my four daughters, my grandchildren, enough money I hope to stay in this apartment, and him." And she pointed to a portrait of her husband who died 10 years earlier. "I'm lucky," she repeated. I learned my newest life lesson. Focus on what you have, not on what you have lost. Yes, acknowledge and grieve the losses, but focus on what you have in your life, because what we have will get us through what comes next. Can I age well? Yes, I can. If I learn how to manage what comes my way and enjoy what I can, if I learn to live in this moment, because this moment is all I have. And that is true regardless of age. However, aging well is not entirely up to the individual older person. It is also dependent upon the availability of resources needed to age well. And responsibility for developing these resources needs to be accepted by the community at large, as well as by institutions in the aging network. And furthermore, they need to be affordable. Let's now examine several key dimensions of well-being: physical, financial, social, psychological, and spiritual. And I promise I won't talk all day. The research, my mother, and now my own experience tell me that good health is the primary component of a good life. I laughed at my mother then, but I do believe she was right. As I experience friends' impairment, I see that disability, even more than chronological age, determines how well we can age. Good health begins with good luck. That is, the genes which we are given. Needless to say, diet and exercise, the shoulds, are necessary to maintain and initiate good health. We're different in so many ways from earlier aging cohorts, especially so in the acceptance of the need to stay fit. So we bike, we hike, we swim, we walk fast, and we walk slowly. To whatever extent possible, continued engagement in these activities for those who can helps with physical, and we're now learning, cognitive well-being. Physical well-being determines in large part the extent to which one has autonomy and control over one's life. And maintaining autonomy and control is for all of us a life goal. Our fears of dependency are aroused almost immediately when we need to ask for help in doing things we were able to do easily before. Asking for and taking help calls for developing a new skill set, skills which we really must learn if we're to maintain our authority. Beyond saying that nobody's independent, that we are all interdependent, remember, please, we've all been socialized to seeing independence as good and dependency as a pejorative, bad. And this saddens me. I see dependency in a different light, and I believe a new perspective on dependency is demanded. Dependency highlights the vulnerability which everyone expresses and experiences, whether we are givers or receivers of help. For dependency tests the strength of people's connections. How much do I mean to them? Who will be there for me? How much can I give back? Questions of loyalty, of worthiness, of love are ever present when issues of dependency arise. I agree with Wendy Lustbader, who writes that it is dangerous to locate our sense of self, our identity, in a place as vulnerable as the body. Financial security is the second component needed to age well, and I'll be very brief here. By this, I mean having enough money to live in an acceptable fashion, even if it means making major or minor modifications in lifestyle, but still permits some pursuit of leisure and personal fulfillment. I come now to social relationships, maintaining or developing them, as the third critical component in the paradigm of aging well. Robert Havockhurst, a Chicago University researcher in the 1970s, found that having even one person in your life in whom you can confide helps maintain equilibrium. In the absence of other connections, social workers and other helping professionals fill the void. Spending time with family or friends in person, by phone, even texting, as well as meeting new people through community engagement, are universally described as essential to well-being. And lucky we are to be in the IRP. Neuroscientists now tell us of a positive correlation between social connections and brain function. Families, neighbors, and friends, which form the core of social relationships, serve different functions at our stage of life. Families are in for the long haul, unless family ruptures have occurred. Families can offer financial support. They can perform the ongoing tasks such as caregiving or providing a place to live. Grandparenting, which may include accepting responsibilities for ongoing childcare, with its joys and heartaches, are part of an increasing number of families' lives. I'm reminded of my encounter with Mrs. Cohen in the Hebrew Home for the Aged, 95-year-old woman who said to me, "Renee, I know what a grandmother does. What's a great grandmother supposed to do?" Relationships with neighbors, on the other hand, are situational. How wonderful to have good neighbors who are present in emergencies, are there for periodic task performance, like shopping or driving, and for social exchanges. Neighbors may stand in for families, but only sporadically and for the short term. Friends, on the other hand, are sometimes like family, sometimes like neighbors with greater intimacy. There are old friends and there are new friends. Old friends are most often the same age as we and face similar life struggles. Their shared histories of families and events. There is mutual psychological and social support if geography hasn't forced a change in this. Old friends know and accept and respect each other's ways. The relationship is sustained despite disparities in physical, emotional, and cognitive health. all the above make losing old friends through death so very hard. They are irreplaceable. We tend not to look to old friends for task performance. They're here for matters of the heart, for having fun, and sometimes doing not such fun things together. New friends, and what a blessing it is to make new friends in older age, and so many of my new friends are here. They tend to be made through community involvement. Insufficient attention has been paid to the importance of having and making friends with younger people, with whom, here we go, reciprocity, while not articulated, is ever present. Younger people, those 10 to 30 years younger than we, keep us au courant. They keep us moving. They help with technology and other tasks. They help maintain our vitality. What do we offer them? Just as we like them, they like us. Younger friends want our perspective, not wisdom. But they want a different way of looking at things. We may become replacements for mothers, dads, other relatives. Role model is the phrase so often used, and what an honor it is. The literature on the value of friendship throughout the life cycle is sparse, despite our knowledge that it is essential for the mental health at all ages. Because the psychological arena, mental and emotional health, is so large, I've chosen to discuss several personality traits which I believe can ease the transition to aging. As context, let me posit what George Valent, who conducted the long-term study at Harvard University, found. That personality does not change that much over the years. Something many of us know, right? Except for good partner relationships and good therapy. Seeing the glass as half full or half empty is longstanding. Change at any age is hard and easier said than done. An old joke captures this. How many people does it take to change a light bulb? One, only one, but the light bulb has to want to change. Having a more positive attitude or seeing the glasses half full does make a difference. I don't know whether you've seen the Jane Brody series that started a couple of weeks ago in the New York Times on positive aging. It's really, really worth reading. It's important stuff. According to a 23-year study conducted at Yale, people who maintained a more positive perception of aging live 7.5 years longer than others. That's a long time. So what helps? I suggest two strategies which do help, I think. Those of adaptability and flexibility, or in the vernacular, rolling with the punches. By flexibility, I speak of the ability to modify existing sources of pleasure. For example, when reading becomes difficult because of macular degeneration, to turn to audiobooks, to large print books, to being read to utilize whatever reading aids are available so as not to give up reading. This change demands a willingness to try and necessitates gaining knowledge of resources and how to access them. It also necessitates that the resources be present. Organizational connections can help here. The Department for the Aging, churches, synagogues, local Ys. Some other examples of flexibility. The move from playing singles to playing doubles tennis. From traveling alone or with friends to joining a group tour from hiking with the Sierra Club to hiking with Road Scholar, which I did last summer, and it was good, really good. Adaptability is different, and it may be more difficult. Adaptability means finding new sources of pleasure, which may become harder as one ages. When arthritis makes sewing or knitting or woodwork no longer possible, to be willing to try something new, perhaps a new craft like painting, or switch gears entirely and try tutoring or volunteer work, or even learn to play chess, which if played with young people can bring other pleasures. Being open to exploration is the key here, as is the availability of desired resources. Personal change is so difficult to make. Beyond expressing willingness to change, and who of us doesn't say we're willing to change? Change involves accepting, internalizing that we can no longer do as we did. It involves considering alternate approaches, thinking, feeling, doing differently from our habituated ways. Whether old or young, people do become creatures of habit. However, the ultimate truth of nature is change. The ultimate challenge in life is how to reconcile these two seemingly opposed aspects of life. Personal change demands emotional vitality. Depression, which is the leading mental health problem of older people, robs people of vitality. 20% of people over 65, one in five people, living in the community struggle with depression, while almost two-thirds of people in nursing homes are depressed and or suffer with some form of dementia. I cannot sufficiently stress the importance of distinguishing between depression and dementia. Depression is reversible with medication and talk therapy, while dementia at this point in time is not. There are better and not so good places to live, and we are the lucky ones. The numbers of people over 60 years of age living in New York City increased by 12% between 2000 and 2016. It's projected to grow to more than 35% by 2030 to 1.84 million people. New York City is listed as the second best city for older people to live in after Portland, Oregon, where my son lives. It is the best retirement community if you can afford it and or learn how to live less expensively. What's best about being over 65 in New York City? Let's mention a few. MetroCard. The new school. What else do I hear? IRP. Health centers. Good. So I'll just summarize it. These are what I listed. Accessoride, the Metro card, reduced price tickets to the movies, available takeout I just heard, the transportation networks. No more driving if you wish not to. Willard Spiegelman says that driving closes the mind to everything except driving. Walking opens it. There's so much to do here. And I'm speaking not only of the museums, of the theater, of concerts, but of the public life. I speak of the crowds and maneuvering them, of the paradox of anonymous company, the bus, the subway, and street conversations we have with strangers. We can be part of the excitement even when sitting on a bench and watch humanity in all its shapes, sizes, and outfits, go by. We can be anonymous or live here as if we're in a small town. I hope the figures on the numbers of people who return here to retire will be available soon. I come now to the fifth component of aging well, and I speak of spirituality. When I speak of spirituality, I'm talking of the search for meaning in life. In the face of my own finality, what meaning has my life had, and what does it hold for me now? These are the existential questions so hard to answer and discuss. The answers are highly individualistic. Eric Erickson posited that the resolution of integrity versus despair is the developmental task for the last phase of life. And he elaborates integrity to mean that we must come to terms with our lives as the only ones we could have had, to come to terms with whom we have become, or is it who we have become? Doing this entails developing the capacity to accept responsibility for our decisions, the capacity to forgive, to let go of our right to retribution, to develop compassion for self and others. Self-acceptance and self-compassion are the desired goals here. The life review process provides the means by which we can examine the past, look at the past to learn what we should be doing in our future. It means learning how accident has played such a large part in our lives, how almost every choice entails regrets, how rarely we knew what we were getting into, and how few people there were to advise us. We can try to put our inner lives in order by reviewing and attempting to resolve life's regrets. In this way, we deal with unfinished business while we're still time to do so. It often helps to do some of this with adult children so that both parents and children deepen understanding of and develop greater appreciation for each other's life struggles. The process of self-acceptance is helped by introspection, which requires just being. Too few of us at any age know how to fill our time without schedules, without activity. We seem to be experts on busyness. We measure success by how much we've accomplished each day. Very few of us attend sufficiently to our inner lives. How many of us spend time in solitude, in being alone, in enjoying our own company, in watching the sunset without guilt about everything else we should be doing? Mental health, cognitive health, physical health is important and depends upon letting ourselves just be, because just being connects us to our authentic selves. I suggest we ask ourselves the following as we search for meaning in our lives. One, what do I want to be? It's never too late to ask that. Two, who did I not get to be? Three, two is who do I not get to be? Three, what have I missed? The search for meaning answers a person's need to work out his or her sense of truth. It gives purpose to life. It gives us a reason to wake up each day. How to find possibilities for life as we cope with the changes brought about by aging is our quest today. Writers from many schools of thought emphasize the importance of being present in the moment, experiencing each moment. Living life fully, they say, make it easier to accept getting sick and growing old. I'm reminded of my dear friend Mary, my colleague at Columbia, who, when she was dying at age 55, assured us she was okay because she had lived a full life. I'll end by sharing with you some of the results of an informal study I conducted in preparation for today. I asked some people, what do you see as positive about aging? Here are some of the results. One, they were no longer as concerned with how other people viewed them. Two, they valued their time more. They did things today rather than put them off for tomorrow. Three, they valued friendships more than ever and became more selective about whom they spent time with. Four, they were more grateful and they expressed gratitude more readily. Don't be sad that it's over, they said. Be thankful that it happened to you. Isn't that wonderful? Five, they had the time to give back to the community as volunteers, as advocates, and to themselves in going back to school. Six, they, and especially women, have become more assertive with age, more in touch with their own needs, and better able to express them. Seven, their perspectives on many issues have broadened. It is important to know the difference between tragedy and burned potatoes. That was Anton Chekhov. Isn't that wonderful? Eight, for those who have them, grandchildren are seen as the gift of aging. I will leave you with the words of Edith Wharton, which in her autobiography she wrote, and I think summarizes the topic for today, aging as well as you can. She writes, "In spite of illness, in spite even of the arch enemy sorrow, one can remain alive long past the usual date of disintegration, if one is unafraid of change, insatiable in intellectual curiosity, interested in big things, and happy in small ways." Thank you. Thank you. Oh. No. Oh. Thank you. We have time for questions and answers. Linda, there are mics. Can you hear, Linda?
Once again, I thank you so much. And I have so much to go over and learn, but the only question I have is, what have I missed in life, that point that you made? And to me, is there a negativity attached to that in any way? Or, I just question that one.
Yes, that's a very important question. In doing a life review, it is important to look at what didn't work out, what the negatives were, as well as what did work out. That makes it real. Our lives have not been all good or all bad. And so we have to look at both pieces to understand where we are now, how we got to where we are now, and where we want to go from here. Thanks, Linda, for that question. Ruth is our walk-around microphone, and this is time for questions and answers. So please put your hands up, and Ruth will come to you. Again? Nope. Oh, that mic. Then take this one.
Oh, I just wanted to expand upon that. What did we miss? And there's that expression, you know, we can have it all or you can't have it all. And I started thinking, do I want it all? And can I handle all?
Lainey, why don't you stand up?
Oh, I'm shy. Can I have it all? And if I did, I couldn't know that I had it all, because it can never be all. And I think I learned that from my daughter.
Ah.
And I think our daughters and our sons, or those young people you talked about, it's a nice balance of things. So I'm grateful for the question, because it helps to remind me that I don't have it all, and I don't even want it all. Thank you.
Thank you, Lainey.
So fabulous, Renee.
Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you. Judy, back there.
Thank you so much, Renee, for this inspiring talk. Is it on? Is this okay?
Yes.
Can you hear me? Okay. However, I'm having a little difficulty right now because of what we're experiencing in the political climate.
Oh.
How we can use that in positive aid. How we can use that to age as well as we can when there are so many barriers being erected right now. And I think thinking of this speech being 6 months ago, it's very different today to age as well as we can. And do you have any recommendations, suggestions, or do others to do that now?
I want to share something very personal with you. The day I felt best after the election was the day we had the Women's March. Yes. Getting active, getting involved, taking our power is the only way to survive this time. We know other bad times, unlike young people today who are experiencing this horror for the first time. But we know that we have to be active, we have to try, we have to do, we have to knock ourselves out to affect what we need. Oh, poor Ruth. Can somebody, she's running around a little bit.
Hi, thank you very much, Renee. I just heard Mrs. Clinton speak recently, on television, of course, and she said that. I just heard Mrs. Clinton speak.
That's better.
Mrs. Clinton said that she believes that misogynism played a role in her losing the election. My question, but it's misogynism from us, women. And my question is, as one gets older, do we get friendlier and more compassionate to our sisters? I have found a lot of women my age, and I will tell you what that is, not as friendly as they could be and helpful to one another. So does that ever change in terms of looking inside and who we are?
You know, that's a wonderful suggestion for research. I have no idea. No idea. I just know that sisterhood is critical throughout our lives. And without sisterhood, you ain't got nothing.
Thank you, Renee. I just wanted to mention
and
that.
And brotherhood.
At 1 o'clock today, there's a going on at Washington Square for Women. The woman who invented the pussy hat is there. So I met her last night, and it's unbelievable. So you get a lot of good stuff if you come to Washington Square at 1 o'clock today.
Thank you, Robin. Thank you very much. Good information.
Okay. Who's next? Okay. I was just struck. Thank you so much.
Thanks,
Renee.
Susan.
I was just struck with when you were saying living in the moment, I remember, 40, 50 years ago. Well, 40.
No, you're too young for 50.
40. But I remember that we were trying to live in the moment in the 60s.
Mm-hmm.
And we're still trying to live in the moment.
And I'm really happy that you pointed out that it's still vital to happiness to live in the moment.
Yes.
So I'm just, thank you again.
Thank you.
The living in the moment is enormously difficult because we're all socialized to what's coming next. But thinking ahead, think ahead. And you're also, I remember as a child, when I was in school, sitting and in the living room and just sitting with the open book on my lap. And my mother said to me, "So what are you doing?" And I said, "I'm thinking." And she said, "Well, come on, you know, you gotta be doing." That's how we grew up. So being in the moment is difficult for everybody, and I think particularly for us.
Renee?
Yes.
I think probably, yeah. I have known you probably longer than anybody yet. We go way back.
We became friends when I was 16.
Yeah, we were counselors in adjacent camp, and she got the guy I wanted, so. For better or worse.
And we're still friends.
And we're still friends. What I wanted to say, though, was I want to thank you because I have felt that in aging, we lose not only friends, but we lose a part of our lives that can't be replaced by anybody else. So that when a friend dies, the things you did with that friend are over. However, this is the first time in all the years I've known you that I heard you speak. And you were just amazing. And so I began to think that you learn new things about your closest friends all the time if you're open to that learning. So you don't really lose in the same way, you can gain.
And Bobby is my friend in the talk who said diminished expectations.
Hello. Firstly, thank you so much. I feel I speak for everyone when I say I was so touched and feel so fortunate to have heard you today. So thank you.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Oh.
And my question is, I subscribe to everything you say and work on it every day. And my mantra is, if not now, when? Mm. My question, though, is I have a sister that's 6 years older than I, in her 70s. And is not able, mm-hmm. for whatever reason, to subscribe to the positive aspects of aging. And as a result, I've become very much of a caretaker because she requires that. Mm. And I guess my concern, and I know there's no panacea, how does one help another person who does everything to undo the joy and the blessings in her life, and yet still maintain our own positive attitudes when we are caretaking for people who, for a number of reasons, choose not to?
Yes. If I could answer that question, it's a position in which many of us find ourselves today. It is enormously difficult, and it takes every ounce of strength to hold yourself together and not to want to shake the person that you love. And what helps, I think, is to try to step back and to self-talk and say, this is the person I love. Remember, I love this person. And not to stay too long in the room where you are being torn apart. Exit the field is very important and helpful to learn.
Renee, I join all the other people in thanking you for today. It was wonderful. I wanted to raise the issue of planning, the issue all of us, or many of us, are in denial about planning for our futures, things like living wills, healthcare directives, you know, things so that our children can deal with that, or our significant others or whoever would have to deal with those issues down the road, which is, I guess, not living in the moment, but living in the next moment.
Mm.
How if you could comment on that and where that fits in.
Yes.
Thank you.
That's the work we have to do today. And I say that, and I say it is more easily said than done, because I'll share with you a story. At Rose Dobroff's, my friend's, memorial service, I noticed a guy walk into the room, and I was able to pull up his name, even though I hadn't seen him in 40 years. I was so proud of myself. I went over, said hello, and then there was another man I saw walking around the room who looked awfully familiar, but I couldn't name him, I couldn't place him. He just seemed nice, so I went over to him and I introduced myself. I said, I'm Renee Solomon, who are you? And he said, I'm your estate lawyer. So, it's very hard. It's very hard to stay with facing your own death and what we have to do. But we have to do it, and this week I finally went back to him. It's only lasted, you know, my knowing him has only lasted about 2 years. And maybe one day I will finish, you know, sign the stuff. Robin?
Yes.
Well, Robin, yeah, I'll repeat. Robin's saying she did that and spent the day with her son working on the material.
It was the most intimate, beautiful, wonderful day I ever spent with him. It was such an emotional connection, an appreciation of each other that I really didn't feel before. So there is a positive sign to it when you do discuss it.
And what Robin began by saying is that she spent the day with her son going over her advance directives, and it was one of the best days she has spent in her life with her son. I highly recommend doing this stuff with your kids or whoever is going to be, you know, part of your advance directives, your healthcare proxy and your power of attorney. I'm assuming, how many of us here are still have still not signed off on this stuff? Okay, yeah, we really are par for the course. And it's helpful to our committee, to know this, because I think perhaps we will sponsor an event on exactly that. Yes. Shh, Penina.
Okay. Does this work?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. I'm making a suggestion about what we can do in answer to the terrible things that are going on in Washington. And the other day, I was looking through a list of all the areas where money is going to be taken away. And among them was Meals on Wheels. Mm. So I thought, well, what could I possibly do about that? And then I live in a group of 10 buildings where there are a number of people who get Meals on Wheels. And I thought maybe I could organize a bunch of people who would do, once a week, would do the deliveries. Mm-hmm. And that would reduce the cost to the organization. They could still send the food and we would do the delivering. That's just one, you know, maybe you can look at the list and see where there's no money and try to volunteer something.
Thank you, Penina. Thank you.
Hello, Renee. Renee, I have to leave now, as you know.
Oh, Bonnie, yes, sorry.
But I wanted to say one thing about Renee as a friend. Renee and I became friends because of a mutual friend named Naomi Berman. Naomi moved to be near her friends, and Renee called me up in September after Naomi had left. And she knew how bereft I was. And she invited me to go and have a ballet subscription with her because she knew that that was something I had done with Naomi. And I just wanted to tell that example of Renee as a friend.
Thank you, Bonnie. Bonnie is an artist who is currently having a show on 21 Ludlow Street at a gallery there, and you are all invited to see Bonnie's work.
The place is called Central Booking.
Thank you, Doris.
I'm concerned about that we don't lose the energy here.
Okay.
And this is a brand new committee. And it appears to me that people of our age have kind of fallen by the wayside. There used to be an organization called OWL, which was older women something.
Right.
And I am hoping, I mean, this may be really stretching it a little too far, but through people here, not everyone here is in the IRP.
Right.
But that there is a nucleus where we could grow something that, whereas Panina, I think your idea is wonderful about volunteering. To me, the better idea would be to go and protest about not having the Meals on Wheels, or doing both. And so that, you know, I kind of wonder if I can put that burden on your committee, which I'm not a member of.
Well, what Doris is suggesting that's missing on the horizon is an organized group of older people, a political organized group of older people, such as the Black Panther, not the Blood, the Gray Panthers. The Gray Panthers, the Older Women's League. Maybe the time has come. I think the time is now. For whatever political organizing we've always wanted to do and never did, if we don't do it now, nobody's going to do it. For us, I mean. Susan.
Yeah, hi. I would like to make a practical suggestion based on an experience I had about a year and a half ago with an IRPer. We were supposed to meet, and I called her to say, are we meeting? And she said, I'm on my way to the hospital. Well, the hospital was near where both of us live. We live fairly close together. And my daughter and I rushed to follow her. And it turned out that she had serious issues. But when we got there, I just said, I'm her cousin. And the reason I said this is I had become the healthcare proxy for my own cousin who had died the previous May. And it made an enormous difference. I said, I'm her cousin. It wasn't true, but they allowed me to bring her water and to get her a blanket, and they gave me full access. I would suggest to everybody in this room that even if your children or your grandchildren or your best friend is your healthcare proxy, you find a healthcare proxy who is no less than a half hour away, mm-hmm. who can be a deputy healthcare proxy in the meantime. Because it makes all the difference between whether you are alone in the hospital in an emergency room or whether somebody can come and assist you with just the most minor things, who can get your keys from you and go to your house and then come back. It's very, very important.
Thank you, Susan. Our committee is certainly going to sponsor another event on that. There's no question. Gloria?
Renee, I want to thank you for that wonderful, wonderful talk. And I hope that you have plans to publish it because you said so many things. Mm. And if I'm lucky, maybe I'll remember more than one. But I do want to read it and examine it and internalize it. And so I hope you do have some plans to publish it.
I'll try.
I want to tell the group about that there is a political organization of older women called the Radical Age Movement. It's started by Alice Fisher,
is
a social worker.
Are you Alice?
No, I'm not Alice. But I'm a friend of Alice.
Alice was supposed to be here with Jackie.
So Radical Age Movement, you can find it online. They had a consciousness-raising session this past week at the Ethical Culture Society, and they're looking for volunteers and people to get active, and it's to fight ageism. I think you should all check it out.
Great. Thank you.
I'm holding the microphone, so I just want to mention that our program is being videoed today, and it will be on YouTube. And so all of you will be able to live and relive this talk. Yes, yes. And if you registered with the IRP and we have your email address, we will send you the link when it's available. Okay.
So everybody, be sure to leave us your email address if you haven't already done so. Yes.
I think she's recognizing.
Were to mention five other wisdom phrases that we could all write down and remember, because it's great when we're here and we're supported by our friends, but when a lot of us are alone, what can we look towards remembering that are points of wisdom? We know that one is know the difference between burnt potatoes and tragedy. What are five others, please?
You're asking me? Well, I certainly would say live in the moment. On your tables, and we're going to spend a little time at the end of this session, there are index cards. If you would write on the index card a response to this question, what words of wisdom would you give someone around being old and growing older? Write it down, we'll compile it, and get it out to you somehow.
Excuse me, how many people are going to want to speak so we could go around fairly here? Okay, well, just a minute. What? You've been waiting a long time? Okay, go ahead.
Yes, I just want to thank you for your wonderful talk, and I'm sorry to hear about our colleague's death. I spent many a lecture listening to her.
Did you?
Yes, I'm a social worker, and to this day I'm supervising a social worker. Oh, is that better? Okay.
Yes.
So I want to thank you for that wonderful speech, and to say I'm very, very saddened to hear about our colleague's death. Last year I didn't know about it.
Yes.
I don't know how I missed it, but... want to say about living in the moment, you might think that it's sad for me to have to use this walker, but in a way, having conditions helps me live in the moment. And for that, I feel very fortunate, because it just brings me into the present and allows me to enjoy every day and every moment. I don't do a lot of futurizing. I just make the most of every moment. What I can do, I can do. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, I say, Eureka. And there's something quite wonderful about that.
Thank you so much for sharing that and teaching us. Thank you.
Okay.
Lynn is coming.
Hi, Rini.
Oh, Nancy.
Yeah, I spent a lot of time with my mom, who was suffering from dementia in Canada, and I noticed in the home where she was, where a lot of other people were suffering from dementia too, there was this attitude of shame and reluctance to really be open about it. And a lady used to meet me every day and say, "Hello, I'm Mary, and I'm not like these other people. I'm not, you know, half crazy and losing my mind." And I just laughed. And then I realized almost every day that I saw her, she'd approach me and say the same thing. "I'm unique. I'm not like these people who are losing their memories." But, you know, the same phraseology, the same thing. And there was this sense of shame and just that. And so I think we're still living with our other prejudices, but our own lack of willingness. I think the word that comes to mind is for ourselves also to be more vulnerable in terms of expressing ourselves to each other, of course, in a safe space.
Yes.
But then I'd like to add this thing about being in the moment. Is you can live that in many different ways. I had a coach at one point, and one point you know, what did I want in life? So I said, I want more love in my life. If you want to not look at external things, but internal, I want more love. And then her recommendation was, well, you can start by being more loving, being in the moment, being more loving. And it really is a transformational thing. You can still, you know, have your fits of pique and have some rants about the political situation and all of that. But if your first point is to be more loving, that's the thing that you can sort of guide yourself and allow yourself some deviations from that and then come back.
Beautiful. Yeah. Beautiful. And I would just add more loving to ourselves as well. More loving with others, but self-compassion is healing. We can be as compassionate to other people, so much more compassionate to others than we are to ourselves. And if we could be aware of how we assault ourselves, we could stop. Period. Carol.
I'm a member of this new wonderful committee, and I'm delighted to be a committee member. I just want to talk a little bit, or Renee, talk about the pink cards are on the table.
Please do, Carol.
Because we need to hear from you about what you'd be interested in hearing as programs. We need help from all of you. So please, there are cards, little pink cards and pencils. Please write down your ideas and leave them with Renee or leave it with one of the people on the committee who will raise their hand. Maybe the committee members could raise their hands.
Committee members stand.
And yeah, we're all around the room. So please leave your ideas because we really need to hear from you. This was a great success. This is our first meeting for the year.
Yes. Are there other questions?
Jerry?
What? Jerry?
Can I just make one more suggestion for political activism? Very simple to do. If you have a smartphone, how many of you have a smartphone? Come on, admit it. All right. You just text 50409. They will tell, and they will tell you, or they will get the name of all your representatives, your senator, your representatives, and then all you have to do to write a fax to them is to simply text to them 50409. It's extremely user-friendly, and if you want to be one of those people that's, you know, getting their, you know, contacting their senators, and obviously we've had an effect, those of us that are writing. So 50409, just text it, and you can get all your representatives, all of your senators, and you can write them at one fell swoop. Okay?
Thanks, Susan.
Jerry? I never thought I would be saying anything, speaking up at this meeting for any reason, just enjoying it and internalizing it. 3 years, but I will, the word love triggered it. 3 years ago, I got a dog.
Go ahead.
And I mention this because this dog has brought such love into my life and has changed my life in ways that I absolutely never expected. Now, I chose to get she is now a 50-pound standard poodle. However, there are little dogs. And I cannot emphasize the change that this dog has made in my life and could do the same for anyone in this room. And so I had to say that. And people
thank
here
you, Jerry.
Who have met the
thank
dog
you.
Know. Yeah.
Are there other questions? If not, I have something for all of us to do before we end.
Hi, I don't know if this is working. I'm on the cusp here, and I'm just trying to get used to this idea of aging.
Yes.
And I want to know, what do you do to maintain self-esteem when you suddenly realize you're walking down the street and you're completely invisible? And I'm not used to this. And literally, people walk into me. It's a literal and a figurative thing.
Personally, I have to say, I never get used to it. It upsets me. And that's part of life, because we live in an ageist society. What else? Are there other responses to this? Linda?
Coming towards me with a big smile. And I thought, oh, he's smiling at me. And then I realized he was smiling at the young blonde behind me. So, yeah, that was sort of the turning point. And we're invisible to many, but we got to keep going.
As long as we are not invisible to ourselves. And that's what counts. Yes.
We always keep our passports with us so they can see that we are over 65. I'm 69, he's 70. This is what 69 looks like now. And there was a note in the window, that's not the point. There was a note in the window of the museum entrance where it said something like seniority, and that was the Spanish word for seniors. So I said to my husband, we're not seniors, we have seniority. So that is in response to the woman who said she's invisible. We have more wisdom than any of the other people walking on the earth. Because we are the age that we are, we glow, we're not invisible.
Okay, one more question, last question.
Not really a question, but in terms of activism, what you just said reminded me that I saw Gloria Steinem on Thursday night, and you know she's the one that said this is what I think it was 70
looks like.
And she was at the Ethical Culture Society with a man by the name of Willie Parker.
May I interrupt for just a second? Please don't leave. I would like us to do a group meditation. Okay.
Anyway, Willie Parker is a man who's providing abortion to poor women, mostly in Montgomery, Alabama, but also he drives takes his life in his hands into other southern states. If you're looking for lots of places to do activism, Ethical Culture Society is a place that's right there on the map doing it. Just go to newyorksocietyforethicalculture.org, NYSEC.org. We are doing things about the environment and about wages and about prison reform. I myself work with my social worker at Rikers Island, we do televisitation. I don't want to talk any longer, but lots of things. Go to our website, and you can find lots of things that probably will interest you. We'd love to have you there Sunday morning at 11 o'clock, and we'll provide you with a free, delicious lunch as a newcomer. Come along. Thank you.
Thank you. The message, the message clearly throughout our Q&A has been to stay active, to stay involved, to stay connected to other people, because that's how we will survive and overcome and make a big contribution to this society. So, is it all right with you if we just end with trying to stay in the moment through a little bit an exercise in meditation? Good. We'll try. Okay. Want you to just get yourself seated, Feel your chair under you. Feet on the ground. Relax. Feel your neck. Feel your shoulders. Ground yourself. And take three breaths. And feel the breath coming into your heart space as you relate to yourself with loving kindness. Close your eyes. Relate to yourself as though you were your little child. And say to yourself, may I open my heart. May I be free from suffering. May I be healed. May I be at peace. May I open my heart. May I be free from suffering. May I be healed. May I be at peace. May I open my heart. May I be free from suffering. May I be healed. May I be at peace. Just breathe into your heart space. And whenever you're ready, come back. That's mine. That's our accompaniment today. Thank you all so very, very much.